And Standard & Poor's is not the only high-profile institution sounding a warning on debt. Leading global economist Willem Bouter says it will be almost impossible for China to achieve a soft landing, and that will have a big ramification for Australia. He says, like the GFC, Australia must be prepared to ramp up government spending. Willem Bouter, to start with Europe, do you see that Brexit will be a net positive for the continent?
No, it's a net negative, especially politically, right? European Union was always a political project, a political move dressed in economic sheep's clothing. There will be some economic costs. They will be greater for Britain, of course, proportionally than for the continent. It will be manageable. Even the UK is likely to manage, unless, well, they manage, but to not to suffer too disastrously unless they have an early hard Brexit. Say, go straight to WTO rules in 2019. That would be extremely tough on the UK.
You've said this morning that you hope that the adults take over in the May administration. What would you like to see them do in order to best manage the exit for Britain?
Clearly accept that there has to be a long transition period, 2, 3, 4 years, during which most of the unacceptables still have to be accepted. So a high degree of free movement, continuing role for the European Court of Justice, and also, of course, there has to be the immediate early agreement on Northern Ireland on the existing EU members in the UK and UK citizens in the EU27, as well as an agreement on the budget. So people have to stop grandstanding, both sides. I mean, in EU27, when it comes to British net financial contribution, they think of a number and double it. That doesn't help either. But on the other hand, when the Brits say, don't have to pay anything, that's also not serious. So if people forget don't think they're in the schoolyard, but this is actually matters for people's lives and for European security, then I think something is negotiable.
Is there any way that the May administration can handle this in that Britain isn't seriously hurt in the exit?
Well, if they get a long transition period, right, and even if they don't get market access, if they don't get membership of the customs union, don't get passporting for financial services, don't get a lot of equivalence that makes up for the loss of passporting, then at least businesses have time, some years, to adjust to the new regime. And if there is real good sense, we might even be able to negotiate something that is closer to the Swiss or even the EFTA model, which has sort of elements of free movement, some continuing role for the Eurozone, so for the European Court of Justice. And it's become more likely actually that they can negotiate something because the European Court of Justice has just ruled that all but two items in foreign trade and investment are an EU competence, not a national one, and therefore can be decided by qualified majority. So there can be no holdout problems on the EU27 side. So a more reasonable negotiation, at least from the EU27 side, is possible. The UK still has to grow up, of course.
In Europe, the dodgiest member is Italy.
Yep.
How likely is it that that economy will crash out?
It's not necessary. The reforms to make the Eurozone viable with Italy in it are clear. They need a sovereign debt restructuring mechanism. They need a completion of the banking union with limiting the exposure of banks to all sovereigns, including their own, risk rating of the sovereigns, much larger stabilization funds, if you want, both to recapitalize banks and to assist governments whose debt has been properly restructured. In addition, it might even be possible to prevent the need for orderly restructuring in Italy if they get through structural reforms that grows up from the near zero rate that it is today to 1.5% in a sustained manner. These reforms are possible, but given the politics in Italy and institutional weaknesses, not terribly likely. So it will be, once the asset purchase program, which keeps the sovereign spreads in Italy under control, once that is over, middle of next year, September the latest, and once it becomes clear that Mario Draghi is not going to be around after the 31st of October 2019, that's when the tensions will come. And if we don't get the reforms, either in Italy or of the euro area institutions, then the unmentionable could happen.
Willem-Buter, in China, do you believe the official figures that come out of the country that tell us that the country is heading for a soft landing?
No, I've never believed the official figures, but I don't disbelieve them any more now than I did last year, the year before. The reason for doubting a cyclical soft landing is that no country has ever had a debt problem, both in terms of the level of debt to GDP and the increase since 2008, and an excess capacity problem of the magnitude that China has, and has been able to work its way out through debt restructuring and excess capacity elimination without at least a cyclical downturn. And it's possible, but it's never been done. So it would be a first if China managed it.
How close do you think that big downturn could come?
Well, not this year, because they will do everything possible to avoid the embarrassment of a large-scale financial restructuring balance sheet repair before the party congress November this year, because that would be an admission of failure, right? That things went wrong even in these last 5 years, the need for this major repair show. So they wait till Xi Jinping has consolidated his power, including the Standing Committee of the Politburo, which has, I think, four people retiring this year. If they are replaced by people who support his vision, then we could sometime next year see an attempt at more aggressive debt restructuring and capacity utilization. And it will be the moment of truth. So sometime, second half 2018 or 2019, we could see the mild downturn we're seeing at the moment become a stronger cyclical downturn.
And what does that actually mean, a stronger cyclical downturn for a country like Australia who relies so much on China?
Now, of all advanced economies, Australia is most dependent on China. Commodity prices would fall, as a major commodity exporter, China would hurt. But of course, Australia just exports a lot of stuff to China as well. I mean, tourism, educational services would all be hurt somewhat. So you'd have to be prepared for that, ready for that, to use monetary instruments, which are a little bit of room, not quite at a zero bound yet, but mainly fiscal stimulus to counteract the slowdown and be willing to let the exchange rate go, of course.
Do you think Australia is ready for that sort of fiscal stimulus? What kind of fiscal stimulus?
Well, ideally, a fiscal stimulus would be infrastructure spending on a project that actually add value. And having coming to the country regularly now for a large number of years, there certainly is no excess of infrastructure. Well-chosen infrastructure, roads, railways, bridges, fiber optic connections, tunnels, local public transport, all that stuff is complementary with private investment as well. But what you need in order to be able to activate it in time is a long list at the federal, state and local level of shovel-ready projects where all the environmental impact assessments have been done, where all the NIMBY issues have been settled, which are only waiting for a yes and the money. And that apparently has not yet been achieved, unfortunately. So I would encourage authorities at all levels to get the shovel-ready project list after a careful cost-benefit analysis ready.
Do you believe this downturn in China is a definite?
Nothing is definite, but it's highly likely. As I said, no country has ever got out of a mess like the one they're in without having a cyclical downturn.
So then, what do you see as the base case for Australia, given what you know about the fact that we don't really have a lot of fiscal stimulus ready to deploy?
You experience an externally driven slowdown in late 2018 and 2019, right? And I expect there will be some kind of response, and you can have a fiscal response that boosts demand even without doing it through infrastructure, but it would add less value. But if it's simply a question of boosting demand, then tax cuts or cookies for grandma can do it too, right? So Australia is blessed with a very low public debt ratio, and it should not be blind to that. No reason to be casual about running fiscal deficits during good times. You should not. But the only reason to be fiscally conservative in good times is to be able to be, you know, fiscally
more
robustious in fiscally exuberant in bad times.
We may have low debt on the government side, but household side, our debts are record high. How much is that a concern?
It is a serious concern. I mean, like Canada and New Zealand, Australia never felt the, you know, the real impact of the great financial crisis. So the debt restructuring, including household debt restructuring, and the puncturing of the housing boom that happened from the US to Ireland to Spain has not happened in Australia. So you're at the end now, I would say, of a housing bubble and a major construction boom. And the household sector is very highly leveraged, I would say, especially if you allow for the fact that house prices are likely to fall rather than rise from here. So it has to be addressed. Macroprudential tools have to be used, I think, effectively. It will be. You can never do these things without pain. The price of excessive leverage is a painful deleveraging, but I don't think, again, that it need be systemic. This the supportive demand sustaining measures can be undertaken by the state if they act wisely to compensate for the weakening of household demand that would come from unpleasantness in the mortgage markets.
Are we going to have to use the government's balance sheet to try and soften an inevitable housing bust?
Well, that's what it's for, isn't it? Yes.
And do you think it's inevitable, a bust?
Of the, nothing is inevitable, but I have never seen a housing bubble and a leverage, household leverage boom like the one in Australia or indeed in Canada that did not end in a bust. So you may set a precedent, right? But don't count on it.
We'll turn to the US, where you've mentioned this morning that we could have another financial crisis in the US, but just not yet.
Yeah.
What are the settings there that makes you think that we're heading for another financial crisis?
Well, non-financial corporate debt is high and rising. It's prices, the risk at a high risk end, very badly, underestimate the risk. Household debt, which had gone down significantly after the great financial crisis, is rising very fast again. The levels of household debt are now at the 2008 level, admittedly relative to disposable income is still a bit lower, and everything from credit card debt to subprime car loans student loans is rising in ways that are not sustainable and potentially dangerous. But I think not yet. It's not systemic yet. Even though $1.2 trillion worth of subprime car loans is nothing to be sneezed at. Commercial real estate, loans secured against multi-occupancy dwellings, has had an enormous boom. A price boom, then followed by a large construction boom. Now supply is, glutting the market, and we're going to see a big price decline and financial strain there. And then finally, of course, we have the banking sector, reasonably under control. They were the ones that were, the drivers of the last great financial crisis. But the shadow banking sector is expanding credit at a rate that is scary. So it's clearly unsustainable what's going on in the U.S. But just because things are unsustainable doesn't mean they can't go on for a long time. And my notion is that they got two or three more years of this late cycle excessive leverage syndrome that you can live with before a domestically generated credit crunch could interfere with US growth.
You also have President Trump looking to water down all of the rules that were brought in to try and prevent a financial crisis from happening again. Do you think that could speed up a crunch?
Yes. Some of the rules were introduced, of course, are dysfunctional. But a lot of the rules, including the CCAR stress test and all that, are important elements of financial stability. And the likely relaxation of these rules, now that Wall Street is regulating Wall Street again, is to bring the next financial crisis forward, yes.
So we've just spoken about the next financial crisis in the US. We're thinking that there will be a housing bust in Australia, that China will have to see some kind of not soft landing at all. Mm-hmm. This seems like a very pessimistic outlook. Are you pessimistic? Are we heading for another sort of crisis?
These are normal business cycles, right? This is the way the world works. We never have smooth growth, right? I'm not predicting a great financial crisis. I'm expecting a cyclical downturn in China, not associated with a great financial crisis, but this credit tightening. Australia and Canada have had housing bubbles and associated leveraged mortgage boom, and that you have to pay for that. But it's, again, it's not catastrophic. It can be mitigated with the tools at hand, especially if the country has as much fiscal elbow room as Australia. In Europe, yes, we can, you know, we have to address the sovereign and sustainability problems of Italy. That doesn't mean that we can't grow in the meantime, and it's even a possibility that they might address it successfully. So I'm not particularly pessimistic. This is normal. The world is cyclical. We always end up at the end of a period of cyclical recovery with excessive growth, with excessive debt, and excess capacity in key sectors. And then you have the downturn and then you start again.
Philip Bauter, it's been great to have you on the program. Thank you so much for your time.
It's my pleasure. Thank you.